Nigel Mansell and Mario Andretti, teammates, friends, and at the moment, the key contenders in the Indy cars. The season's first race saw the reigning Formula One champion run pole to checkered to take his first win in his first race. 2 weeks later, in practice, it was a different picture, as Mansell shattered the Phoenix wall, was hospitalized, and would not race. Mario Andretti was left to carry the team colors. He qualified on the front row and jumped to an early lead, hoping to end the 73-race slump. Tracy took over and lapped the entire field twice and then crashed. Emerson Fittipaldi took the lead and crashed. And now, for the first time in 5 years, Mario tasted victory and joyfully took the win and the points lead. The first driver to win in each of 4 decades and the oldest race winner in IndyCar history. Today, it's round number 3 of the PPG IndyCar World Series on the streets of Long Beach. Mario and Nigel have teamed on these streets before when it was a Formula One race, and Mario won. Mario then returned to the IndyCars to win here in 84 on his way to the IndyCar Championship, and again in 85 and 87. But these streets can punish their champions. In 89, Mario led the 88 champ, Al Unser Jr., only to be punted aside to make it 2 in a row for Al. Here, the unusual is commonplace, as 86 winner Michael Andretti and Emerson Fittipaldi found out. As did Al Unser Jr., going for his 5th win when he touched with Danny Sullivan. Sullivan went on to take the victory and is back to defend his title in the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach. Have been cleared. It's a beautiful day, and we're ready for the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach. Hello, I'm Paul Page. There's an electric excitement in the crowd here, and Sam, very definitely an international flavor.
Oh, exactly. 8 out of the top 10 qualifiers were born outside of the United States. The Formula One world champion is in the race. It's gotten to the point where they check your passports instead of your pit passes almost, but a foreigner has never won this race.
But if one could, perhaps it would be Nigel Mansell, but Bobby, he's in pain.
Paul, he is. As we all know, he had a bad crash at Phoenix. His back is hurting really bad, not healed up completely, complaining about his wrist and hands a little bit. Everybody in the pits is looking today. They know he'll go fast, but can he finish?
All right, Bobby, let's take a look at the starting field here on the pole with a new track record. It is Nigel Mansell. In the second row, or in the front row alongside, is Paul Tracy, who made his IndyCar debut here 2 years ago. In the second row, Emerson Fittipaldi, twice a runner-up here at Long Beach. And Scott Goodyear, the winner of last year's Michigan 500. In row 3, Stefan Johansson with his best start ever in an IndyCar event. And Mario Andretti, a 3-time champion here. It's course at Long Beach.
Paul, this is one beautiful course. About 1.5 miles around, 8 turns down the front straightaway, almost 190 miles an hour.
So that's the circuit here at Long Beach. The field maneuvering behind the Toyota Supra twin turbo and now ready to roll into their formation. The race record here, 91 miles an hour. Danny Sullivan, the defending champion from last year. The field now beginning to align. At the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach, on the pace lap now, the field beginning to align and looking for a green flag. The third race of the IndyCar season is about to begin with Nigel Mansell on the pole, and already there's a problem as Stefan Johansson touched with another car and sits against the wall. Mansell takes the field down to turn 1, but how will they react to this in terms of yellow flags? They've already slowed it down. Yellow flags wave all around the course. Stefan Johansson touched somebody. He's already out of the car, so thankfully he is all right. But as they came around the very tight hairpin that leads to the pit straight here and the start-finish line, 2 cars got together. We've not yet identified the other, but Stefan Johansson also caught the wall, and look how angry he is. Here's the replay of that situation as they were coming off the corner, Bobby. Just got crowded way to the...
It just got crowded. All it happens is it's so crowded coming off the hairpin turn. Looks like Mario. Yeah, Mario and Stefan touched tires. You know, especially when they're going that slow, the tires just climb it like they would a rock, climb the other tire.
Stefan had qualified 5th in Tony Bettenhausen's car, so it was a big development in the race.
Here's what it looked like from Al Unser Jr.'s car, that same situation when Stefan Johansson... No, apparently we don't have that. As Stefan Johansson got... tapped by Mario as they were coming off the turn. It is a very narrow area.
Now, one of the first things people are going to think about is, what is this going to do to the mileage? Well, in fact, they're going to count the laps under the yellow. For the other guy, just going to, here's the...
That's from Little Al's car. Now, just look ahead. Perhaps we can pick out the two cars. They are turning into the hairpin. And on the exit of this corner.
And you can see, Stefan was on the right-hand side and came over just a little bit, got way up in the air, almost turned him over, Paul.
So the yellow flags wave all around the circuit. Here the start is aborted, but they will be counting these laps. We'll be right back. Your hands. Line, single file at this moment, trying to give everybody plenty of room as they come off the corner. And Nigel Mansell will lead that field down as he moves toward the inside. And we are ready to go racing again as that green flag comes out. The rest of the field straggles through and heads for the first turn with Paul Tracy moving ahead of Mansell as they head into turn one. Then Mansell, then Fittipaldi. Then a bit of a separation as Fittipaldi got on the brakes early coming into the corner. But now Nigel Mansell is chasing Tracy. I asked Rick Mears this morning, what would he tell Paul Tracy about the start of this race? Should he just lay back and wait for Mansell? And Rick said, no, I'm going to tell him to go for it. So he's following his coach's orders perfectly and pulling out some distance on Nigel Mansell. In third, Emerson Fittipaldi now being passed as a terrific battle, developing for third place as well. Scott Goodyear in there. As he comes up now behind Mansell, and Scott Goodyear has been having to handle up Emerson Fittipaldi. But Scott Goodyear firmly in control of third place now. They come to Shoreline Drive. There's Scott Goodyear as he comes onto Shoreline Drive in third place. And here they do get a chance to breathe, a chance to rest. Fittipaldi, then Mario Andretti. So if there were any questions about Mario Andretti's car, it appears to be in fine working order. Here comes Andretti inside of Fittipaldi. Allenzer Jr. closes in behind Fittipaldi as well. Then Teo Fabi in the yellow car. Then Raul Boisel sitting just back a few feet. And already they have to deal with slower traffic. Trying to understand why Marco Greco was in there. He must have ducked in and out of the pits during those early laps. But now they have to deal with the slower car, that number 30 car of Marco Greco. Here comes the challenges. Fittipaldi fighting now with Allenzer Jr. and Teo Fabi looking for position to the out five. Little Al gets around Fittipaldi. Now Teo Fabi looks for a chance to fight with Emerson Fittipaldi.
Little Al had the fastest speed in warm-up this morning, so he has a setup that is very good for the race itself.
Early battle at the front of the field. Paul Tracy was in front. Then Nigel Mansell, Scott Goodyear, Mario Andretti. Mario has radioed his pitch and said that that confrontation on the start was not his fault. But I'm sure, Bobby, that's going to be examined quite some degree.
It's a place on the track where there's always a problem. If one guy doesn't give the other guy just a little bit of breathing room, those kind of things happen to start here because they go through that hairpin just before the start.
You're looking back from Nigel Mansell now as he has Scott Goodyear filling up his rearview mirrors. They come to a key passing area, but Scott Goodyear decides to sit and wait at this point.
And we've always got to remember, Mansell, remember the crash I mentioned. Is he going to pace himself? Now, it would look right now like he's going to pace himself. He's in there for the long haul. Also, when Mansell comes around that hairpin, he just went through. I want everybody to watch. He has a different groove than all of the other cars that are racing here, even the slow ones. But he's been the fastest guy most of the days.
Gary Gerald, an update, pit side.
Well, we get a radio conversation. Mansell happy with the way the car is working. He told the crew, don't worry. He, being Tracy, is just using his tires up. So Mansell apparently is happy to run in second at the moment.
Paul Tracy just dusted off the fastest lap of the race at the conclusion of lap 7, 104 miles an hour leading this race. Mansell is now sitting back about 5 seconds with Scott Goodyear all over the back end of Mansell. There you see the battle. As second place goes into the corner off of Seaside. Here's that corner you were talking about, Bobby.
Yes, and these two lowest, incidentally, and one of them, the one that Mario's driving, or that one right there, Mansell, that one and the one Mario's driving, and Scott Goodyear's cars are different lowest. The underneath part of them, where the ground effects takes effect, are different. They've done some side designing on their own.
So Nigel Mansell, who was so dominant in Australia, now is chasing Paul Tracy here in Long Beach, California, with Scott Goodyear looking strong behind him. And look at Mario and Al Unser Jr. as they go into the corner side by side. Remember a couple of years ago when they didn't get through there quite that smoothly. But little Al now moves around Mario Andretti and picks up fourth place.
Breakthrough, ironically, came after yesterday. They made some changes last night. Both of the cars, Little Al and Sullivan, are going much better today.
Well, they got their cars late among the leaders.
Robbie Gordon with Ray Hall making a move, but Gordon darts to the inside and slows down. During practice, he had a problem with fifth gear. This gives Tao Fabi an opportunity to charge at the back of Ray Hall. And around comes Sullivan as well.
Well, you can see Ray Hall just pull over to the inside, blocking the other guys going into that turn, trying to protect his position there, Paul.
But what happened to Robbie Gordon? He pulls to the side on the straight and then seems to come back up to speed.
Here's the view from behind Ray Hall's car. You can see Bobby falling back. Here they come, Ray Hall at the bottom of the screen with Bobby in the yellow car.
No contest as they come off of Seaside and turn back, making that final left-hand turn toward the hairpin. Sullivan closing on the Pennzoil car. That belongs to Tao Fabi. They come onto the straight. Tremendous acceleration at this point.
You notice how Danny Sullivan is really staying in line. He's getting all the drive he can get, trying to get a run right there. Now, he almost made that pass. He didn't make it quite, but he used the draft all the way down that straightaway, then whipped it out right at the very last. And boy, you can really see it on the onboard cam.
So Sullivan tries to make a move on Tao Fabi, can't get it done. Paul Tracy continues to lead this run. Nigel Mansell continues to run in second. Paul Tracy in that 12 car. Look at the lead that he has. We'll be back. Little Al can't do it. He gets caught behind Ari Leyendijk. He has to move to the inside. He continues his pursuit of
there. There he is, taking Ari on the outside. Remember, when you ride with Little Al like this, you're riding with a four-time winner and a man who is thinking not so much that he's getting through these guys, but that he's got to worry about Mansell and Tracy out in front of him running two and one, respectively.
The view from the Goodyear blimp over the track here. They scream down toward turn one. They start down through the gears. There are slower cars ahead. And still, Little Al can't get it done.
You know, and as we watch, Little Al's in a Chevrolet. The car on the right-hand side, the blue car just ahead of him, that's a Ford-powered car. I think one of the things we're going to be watching all year is Ford against Chevrolet. Chevrolet against Ford. And as we watch the blimp shot from the Goodyear blimp, you can really see that. Look at this. You can really see what happens to the engines. Just the engine. Ford power down the straightaway.
This view gives you a tremendous opportunity to study the different rates of closures. They both move around Buddy Lazier in the Viper car, and now Al Unser Jr. gets back in contact as they come to the hairpin, and they should have a fairly open straightaway ahead of them if only Little Al can gain enough revs as he comes down the straightaway to get on the back end of Scott Goodyear's car.
Yes, he needs to get a little bit closer to get a good draft. Even though these cars are so streamlined, so aerodynamic, they still need a little help for drafting.
Listen to the gears. Seaside, the battle now develops here between Eddie Cheever and Robbie Gordon. It's a battle for ninth place. Al Unser Jr. for the moment broken off in his fight with Scott Goodyear. This is the hottest battle on the circuit. Right behind Gordon, Tao Fabi and Scott Pruitt. Just got a glimpse of Paul Tracy in car 12, the leader of the race.
We watch Robbie Gordon come off of that hairpin turn with a rear end hanging out. That kid is really trying hard.
Whatever was ailing his car earlier no longer affects it because he's staying hot in the fight. Bobby continues to try to attack him. Back at the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach as Paul Tracy, the leader, has shredded his left rear tire and is limping for the pits. Nigel Mansell will take over the lead of the race. Jack Roots right there.
And Paul, this is seven laps earlier than they had hoped to bring the car on pit road. He skids to the stop and look at the condition of the tire. Jerry Breon pulls it off and puts it back on. This is unfortunate because part of the problem was they had fuel mileage problems in Australia. They had solved them, and you're talking to Richard Buck, and now they've stalled the car. He said that this was going to work in their favor. They cautioned early on, and they were stockpiling fuel mileage. That's all gone away now.
19 seconds in and out for Paul Tracy, but he fell well down through the order. Now in sixth place as Nigel Mansell assumes the lead.
When he ran into trouble, he had an 8.5 second lead over Mansell, who you see here. Now Tracy has led 57% of the laps this year going into this race. You see what happened to him here. The left rear tire of Paul Tracy shredding suddenly. That's the back straightaway there. He was lucky or very skillful to control the car and bring it into the pits as fast as he did.
Well, the whole trick, Sam, is going to be, why did it shred? Why did it go bad? Tires don't just blow on their own. So there's a good chance, and that's what we'll have to watch for. They might have bent something while he was blowing or shredding that tire up.
So Nigel Mansell now sits in the lead, nearly 7 seconds ahead of Allenzer Jr. 7 seconds further back from that is Scott Goodyear. And then Mario Andretti is unchallenged another 10 seconds further back from Goodyear. Look at the interval here. We keep track of Mansell and Al Unser Jr., first and second place. And, of course, as they come to the pit stops, that interval will be critical. Eddie Scott Pruitt in the pits was by looking at videotapes of every race, including every onboard camera he could get his hands on. He's really gone to school on IndyCar racing.
And that's good that he did that, and it shows the amount of interest Paul Buck. He doesn't realize or doesn't know until he runs with them that these guys' personalities change often through different types of tracks.
Raul Boisel makes his stop. He was running eighth just prior to coming into the pits.
He was, of course, second at Phoenix 2 weeks ago, and one of the quiet men of racing, a real accomplished guy, though.
But what a great race driver he is. Tremendously agile in almost any kind of race car. Former NASCAR champion.
This is lap 39 with all the cars. This is Robbie Gordon in. All the cars are going to have to be coming in the pit. None of them should be able to go past 40 laps.
They look over the back of that car while they refuel it and change tires. No obvious work other than the routine maintenance being done on Robbie Gordon's car. So his first stop here at the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach is complete.
It takes a long time to fuel them. It looked like a slow pit stop. Really, it wasn't. It's just that the cars right now, 40 laps, are really just about empty.
18 and a half seconds, long stop. Danny Sullivan is in now. Sullivan was running in fifth place prior to this stop. And they expect his teammate, Al Unser Jr., to come in next time around. So they bring Sullivan in first, get it cleared so this man, Little Al, can make the turn in.
And I also remember, Paul, that the telemetry that tells the pits when the guys really need fuel. Here's Little Al in now.
So Al Unser Jr. comes in for a stop, Jack.
And, Paul, this is a scheduled pit stop. They're trying to extend their fuel mileage window. They will change tires, and now it falls off the jack for a second. The air hose not going in properly. They are going to exchange tires, fill it with fuel. They radioed to Al Unser Jr. about 7 laps ago that he could go ahead and turn things up a bit. That means he could expend a little bit more fuel mileage, but he's away. Remember, though, there is a pit speed limit here, and a lot of the drivers are getting real close to violating it.
Well, of course, that's a contest, isn't it?
As they come out of the pits, there is a battle for third place as Scott Goodyear is sitting just ahead of Al Unser Jr.
Long Beach track has made a terrific difference. Here comes Little Al down the outside.
Al Unser Jr. looking for room.
Oh!
Comes around to the inside, kind of tries to fake Mansell to one side. And he touches him! He touches Mansell, and you see the suspension drop on the back of Mansell's car. It looks like there is damage there.
A Little Al's car. The left front is bent. He's out of the race. Just a little touch like that sometimes bends him completely. That's the same place. The Little Al touched Mario Andretti a couple of years ago. Same turn.
And an ongoing fight for second place there. Now Paul Tracy does have some breathing room, especially if we have to keep watch on Mansell's car. Little Al climbs out of the car, obviously not injured, but there's damage there. Mike Nigel Mansell may also have damage. We look at it again. Here they come into the corner. Little Al looking for room. He set him up on this. They get together. It's hard to believe that Mansell's car doesn't have a problem, too.
Well, he's on the rear. The rear's a lot stronger than the front, Paul. And the thing about it was that Little Al should have known that Mansell can't see him. That's in that blind spot of the cars, and Mansell had to be looking to the left. Little Al could have passed him on the outside. The road is just not wide enough.
Well, if it's going to affect Nigel, it hasn't appeared yet.
Obviously, great disappointment. Tell us what happened as you battled for that position.
Well, Nigel and I, we were running together, and he's just blocking very, very well, I guess, you know. And then I got him, he got a little bit too much blocking me on the inside going into turn one, put him on the outside of turn two entry, and it screwed him up a little bit. I was set up for it, and I did him on the outside. And then when we came off a turn two exit, he squeezed me against the wall.
Did you think you had him cleanly passed?
I had him covered. He knows exactly where I am when I'm behind him, but as soon as I got beside him, he lost where I was. So, which is BS. The guy, you know, what can I say?
All right.
We'll handle it.
Thank you, Al.
Allinger Jr., his first DNF here at Long Beach since 1985. Pretty disappointed, Bobby.
Yes, I know he's very disappointed. You know, they've had such a hard time getting that car worked. The whole Gallus crew, they're all going to be so disappointed, along with little Al, because this is the first time this year they've had anything fast at all. Yep. He's in the golden brown car right there, the number 9 car.
71 laps of the scheduled 105 lap distance, 167 miles, as Robbie Gordon in the midst of all that. In trouble again, and he touches Cheever. He touches Cheever. Then Fittipaldi stacks the brakes, so does Pruitt. And Ari Leyendyke comes to a stop in this turn, is badly crowded now. They'll have to take incredible care. Yellow flags, I'm sure, flying all the way down Seaside. You can see these course marshals here. By the way, the course marshals are all volunteers, and they take incredible chances to try to keep this race going. They're here all week, and they do a magnificent job, as you see they're doing now. Leyendyke trying to get going, looking for help. He needs somebody to push him forward so he can get back into the run.
We just sat here, and we can grunt for him, you know. I mean, he needs to get going. Unfortunately, this hairpin turn is so narrow and so hard to get through.
Here comes Mansell.
The tracks get blocked.
Mansell comes in, tries an inside line. Very carefully through the corner. Of course, the yellow flag is there, but still, there's plenty of debris down there, and those cars are in the way.
This is a real bonus for Nigel Mansell and the Newman Haas team, because, Paul, they made that last stop at lap 58. That meant there were 47 laps to go to the finish. Not enough fuel to do it. Now they'll get the complement of fuel. He won't have to go any further as we go to Jackaroo.
Well, Gary, they also completed a stop here with the Roberto Guerrero car, who was running in second. Let's check
to Green. He's led 203 of the 341 laps available this year. He continues his lead, but now, tacked right on his back end, is Mario Andretti and Nigel Mansell, as they both maneuver for position. And Fittipaldi, not a factor back there. He's several laps behind the lead.
And remember, the big change, Paul, was during the pits, of the people that didn't see it, as Mario beat out the guy right behind him, number 5, Mansell, out of the pit. Mansell had no idea that that was going to happen.
Mario, in a sense, ambushed him, I think, as he was leaving the pits, the only place he could overtake him. Now Nigel is going to have to do the overtaking under Green out on the racetrack. You know, they're teammates, but they're very aggressive men with an awful lot of pride, and there's no team orders that such one driver or the other should win the race. They are racing for the victory individually.
So Fittipaldi in that 4 car is not a factor. He is running in 16th place, but the rest of these cars are all fighting at the front of the field. Tracy followed by Andretti, followed by Mansell, by Bosell, by Roberto Guerrero.
And one Chevrolet leading it, 2 Fords following it. The same team right there. Mario Andretti, Mansell on your left. They're trying to outbreak him going in.
Mansell, who is incredible at running down on the inside of the racetrack, slapping those brakes, riding the brakes all the way to the corner. Scott Pruitt takes a stop and go penalty, speeding in the pits. They have changed that now. We had one of his crewmen that was injured in the pits, not yet identified to us. And this stop and go was a result of leaving the pits with hoses still connected. And we'll try to get an update on his crewman as well, let you know what happened there.
That's a new team. Maybe the guys just aren't experienced enough together right now, because, of course, the driver always wants to leave in a hurry, and I think that's what happened, Paul.
Watching at the front, no change in the order, though Ray Hall is closing in on Roberto Guerrero.
This is a very fraught situation, because Nigel Mansell's been a little bit faster than Mario throughout much of the day, but he now must get by Mario, and Mario is very aggressive at defending himself on a course like this.
I think we can easily assume that by now we're not too far from the end of the race, and Mansell is very tired and very sore from his injuries in Phoenix, and it kind of looks like he's not as aggressive as he normally is.
Battle for fifth place, the 40 car, Roberto Guerrero. Ray Hall right behind him. Goodyear just back from Ray Hall. Fifth, sixth, and seventh. There's Bosell also in the fight as well, just ahead of Guerrero. off the edge of the course, and it is Mario. Mario Andretti sits off the edge of the course. He was running in second. His daughter, Barbie, disappointed. Mario was going for two in a row. We have no idea why he's sitting by the edge of the course with the engine shut off. Could it be fuel? Not likely. 21 laps ago was his last stop.
Now, obviously, it's going to be some sort of a power, either the engine or the power train, because it just quit completely, and he didn't coast very far with it, Paul.
Mario waiting for assistance from the course marshals. Gary Gerald, you're in that pit. Can you give us an update?
Well, the one word we heard, they believe it's electrical, Paul, and it looks like it's a terminal problem, and the man who was leading the points chase, trying to get two in a row, sits on the side.
And Carl Hogan now has that information. Obviously, they're discussing the fact that they think Paul Tracy's going to have to stop, and if he does, then that will turn the lead of the race over to Bobby Rahal. Let's go back to Jack Arruth. Jack?
Well, Paul, when they heard what happened there, they radioed to Bobby Rahal, take it easy on fuel. They don't believe what we're hearing from the Penske pit. They think that Tracy is going to have to pit one more time. They want to make this an economy run and maybe go to victory lane.
Well, also, Jack, Rahal is 14 seconds back, so there's probably very little chance, no matter how hard he went, that he could close that gap on Tracy. So they're doing tactically the superior thing right now.
But that interval, Jack, is not the key interval. As you see him on the straightaway, you'll notice that Boissel is only 2 seconds back from Rahal. So there's still a battle developing there. Jack, back to you. I'm in the Rahal Hogan pitch. Let's go to Gary.
Carl Hogan, can you catch Paul Tracy at this rate?
No, I don't think we can. We're going to be lucky if we run out. I mean, we run through the race with the fuel. We're right on the button, so we're pretty happy where we are. We're just trying to make sure we maintain second at this point.
All right, thank you.
All right, good.
Carl Hogan loves to race. There's his driver and his partner, but they are doing everything they can. They're charging. I'm not so sure I believe what he said. I think they think they've got a
I don't believe it either. Remember that they won the IndyCar Championship last year in their first year team together.
And Boissel slows down. Now, is this an indicator of anything? Boissel slows down, sitting in third place, but what I'm wondering is he out of fuel?
It has that look.
And if he is, what does that say about Tracy and Rahal?
Well, we're back to the telemetry, all the new modern stuff that's computerized. They all tell the pit crews everything is happening, but it doesn't always read right.
Could this provoke a yellow, which would shake things up? Here comes Rahal.
Paul Tracy sitting 7 seconds in front of Bobby Rahal as we watch for the white flag.
You can see how straight Rahal comes off the turns. Look at how easy he's going through here. He's conserving also. It always comes down here at Long Beach to fuel at the latter part of the race. Seems like it never changes.
Paul Tracy right now is closer to winning his first IndyCar race than he has ever been. You get the feeling it's something that's going to happen if there's just enough fuel left in that tank.
And Rahal has come by the start-finish line very, very slow. He picks up speed now as he heads down into turn one. There's Paul Tracy, the 12th car. He is so close to a victory, and I'm telling you, once he wins, he is going to be very hard to catch. He fell off a mountain bike that he was playing with earlier in the week. His hands are cut and bruised. His right ankle is very sore. He was icing it down heavily yesterday, but I don't imagine he feels any of that now as Paul Tracy on his final three turns, and he will look at a checkered flag if only he can make it here through the hairpin in safety. Paul Tracy makes a turn onto the straightaway. The checkered flag will lie just ahead, and Paul Tracy has finally done it. He wins an IndyCar race. Paul Tracy becomes a champion in the IndyCars, the 10th different driver to win in a Penske car, and Paul Tracy has done it. Bobby Rahal comes across the line in second place, but very slowly. Here he goes as he came well off of the pace. Nigel Mansell should cross the line in third, and it's a celebration in the Penske pits, and Carl Hogan's pretty happy about it as well. Pretty good celebration for second. We'll be back to talk with the winner of the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach. One very terrific run.
Well, Paul Tracy, welcome to IndyCar Victory Lane. You're first.
Well, it's a credit to the Marlboro team. We had two flat tires during the race. I just can't even believe it. You know, we just fought back all day, ran strong with the Marlboro car. You know, I have to, you know, just thank the crew for that one. They did the job, got me in and out of the pits real well, and I got to thank them.
Adds new meaning to patience. I bet you learned one here.
Well, it's You know, we stayed in there all day, and, you know, we ran it, and I'm just happy to be in the winner's circle.
Paul?
So Paul Tracy takes his win. Nigel Mansell finishes in third and takes the point standings by 4 points over Mario Andretti, his teammate. Paul Tracy is the winner of the race here in the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach. Bobby Rahal second, Nigel Mansell third. Teo Fabi comes home fourth, followed by Roberto Guerrero and Robbie Buell. It has been one terrific day here in Long Beach. A tremendous race, and Roger Penske's team comes out on top. Of course, the next stop is the Indianapolis 500, the greatest spectacle in racing. Many stories yet to be told and tests yet to be run as we take a look down through the entire final results. It's been a great day under beautiful skies. Nigel Mansell now moving to the point standings with his third place finish here. Bobby Unser, you really love that one.
Certainly one of the best races I have ever seen in Long Beach, and unpredictable from the start to the finish.
And Sam, as we said, always electric.
Paul Tracy's 17th IndyCar race has produced a win, and I think we're looking at the beginning of an era where we're going to see him win a lot more.
What a great day and what a great year for IndyCar racing. We're on our way now to the Indy 500. I'm Paul Page. So long from the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach.